This video was brought to you by GeneralPAC.com, making power systems intuitive, open, and free to everyone, everywhere. Consider subscribing and supporting through patreon.com/GeneralPAC. This is the mechanism for you to support us financially so we can continue making high-quality power system video tutorials. Our corporate sponsor for this topic is AllumiaX.com from Seattle, Washington. Contact them for industrial and commercial power system studies. This is the second part of topic 2 in the series of electric machines, and in this part we will be introducing the induction motor. Now, in the previous part we discussed introduction to AC machines, and now we will be talking about the basics of induction motors, which includes their construction and working. This is going to be a short tutorial for the purpose of building up to the next few parts, and we have a long way to go, so let's get started. In the induction motor, the voltages are induced on rotor bars through the magnetic fields created by the stator, and that is why it's named induction motors. Now let's move forward to the construction of an induction motor. As discussed in our previous parts on the introduction to AC machines, in AC machines have two parts. We have the stator and we have the rotor. Within the stator, the main part is the three-phase stator winding, which produces the rotating magnetic field. Each of these phase windings have several number of turns, and each turn is separated with the other through insulation. As we know that flux passes through a metal easily as compared to the air, and for this purpose, to complement the stator windings, we have the stator core, which consists of a soft iron in order to reduce hysteresis losses, and it is laminated so that eddy current effects can be reduced. For the protection of motors from external environmental factors and to give it overall strength to the structure and provide good heat dissipation, a metal frame is used to house the stator. Now let's move on to the rotor construction parts. Now, as discussed previously, we have two types of rotors. We have the squirrel cage rotor and we have the phase wound rotor. Now the first thing that strikes about this is that why is it called a squirrel cage rotor? It is because the construction looks similar to an exercise wheel of a hamster or a squirrel, so they just called it a squirrel cage rotor. Now a cage rotor consists of aluminum bars which are shortened together at both ends by aluminum rings so that the induced current may flow through them. These conducting bars are generally skewed. And they are twisted at an angle instead of being straight. The skewing serves two purposes, which are to increase the starting torque by increasing the bar resistance, and secondly, to prevent the magnetic locking of rotors, or else the motor will not start. So let's move on to the discussion of phase wound rotors. So the only difference in phase wound rotors is that instead of having bars, the rotor has three phase winding, which is similar to that of a stator winding. The windings are connected to an external rheostat through slip rings and carbon brushes, which are present on the rotor shaft. Now, the purpose of a rheostat, or a variable external resistance, that's what a rheostat is to achieve the desired torque by changing the rotor resistance. Now that's all for this part. Now in the next part, we will be talking about the concept of slip rings and equivalent circuits of an induction motor. We hope that you have a continued interest in this topic and series, either as a student or a professional. We hope you find this content useful and enlightening. Please consider subscribing to GeneralPAC.com or becoming a patron at patreon.com/GeneralPAC. We make power systems intuitive, open, and free to everyone, everywhere. Thank you.